गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन।
गुड आफ्टरनून मैम। गुड
आफ्टरनून मैम।
सो व्हाट वी हैव सीन इन द लास्ट लेक्चर, वी हैव स्टार्टेड विद अवर थर्ड यूनिट दैट इज हैमिल्टोनियन, हैमिल्टन्स फंक्शन। इन द थर्ड यूनिट वी आर गोइंग टू सी हैमिल्टोनियन। कैन एनीवन एक्सप्लेन मी व्हाट इज हैमिल्टन्स प्रिंसिपल? This is what a principle. Consider a dynamical system from one point to another point within the time interval from t naught to t one. Out of all the possible paths, the system will choose a path along which the line integral of Lagrangian is extremum. The example we have given for a class of MSc first year is allowed to move from position p to q within the time interval t naught to t one. After that, we have derived the Lagrangian equation of motion from Hamilton's formulation. Okay, these things we have already seen in the last lecture. So after that we have defined the new L dash, and now we have verified whether that new L dash also satisfy the Lagrange's equation of a motion. For that, first we have found dou L dash by dou qj, then we have found the dou L dash by dou qj dot, and then we have found the derivative of L dash with respect to qj dot, and then we have subtracted those terms and we get the result. Okay, this is what an equation 1 and this is equation 3. Subtracting equation 1 and 3. So you can see here from 1 and 3 we can have the result is that L dash also satisfy Lagrange's equation of a motion. The next thing we have seen is delta variation in the value of L dash should also be equal to 0. That is, new L dash, with the help of new L dash also, we have to show that delta variation in the value of a line integral is equal to 0. Okay, so here there is no variation in the path, hence we can say delta t is 0 as well as delta qj is 0, and hence we get the result. Okay, and we have started with this Hamilton formulation. That means how H looks like, or where you can say L is a function of qj, qj dot and t. So h will be a function of pj, qj and t. So the quantity summation over j pj, qj dot minus L can be represented in terms of q1, q2 up qn, p1, p2 up to pn and time t. This type of a formulation we call the Hamiltonian formulation. Okay. And next we have defined Hamiltonian function. Then we have found the Hamilton's canonical equations of motion. I have told you these equations of motion are very important for your set net as well as theory examination. These equations, qj dot is equal to dou h by dou qj, dj dot is equal to minus dou h by dou qj, and dh by dou h by dou t is equal to minus dou l by dou t. Okay, these equations we have already derived. Dj dot is minus dou h by dou qj, and qj dot is dou h by dou pj, dou h by dou t minus dou l by dou t. The last equation no need to remember, simply you have to remember these two. Okay, the last two one will with the negative sign, first one that is qj dot is with positive sign. Okay, you have to by heart these equation so that at least one question in the set exam will be fixed on. Mostly ask this type of a question and show that the coordinate which is cyclic in Lagrangian is also cyclic in Hamiltonian. Okay. So we have proved this. After that, I told you that this question is many times asked in the set exam by some creating some confusions. Right, first one, what is given to us? Firstly, it is a conservative system. Okay. Simply we have provided that first it is conservative system. In case first, when the constraints are scleronomic, then the Hamiltonian H represent both the cost of motion and total energy. And when constraints are reonomic, may represent cost of motion, but it does not represent the total energy. So what we have seen in the last lecture, we have derived that dH by dt equal to zero. Whenever you want to show any function to be constant, you can show that the derivative is equal to zero. Okay, dH by dt we have shown equal to 0, which means that h is a constant of motion. And the next one, we have to prove H is L3 present the total energy. As L does not contain the time T, so with the help of that, we can say that T is equal to summation over J Pj Qj dot. If you want to remember this equation, you have to go back to our first chapter and then you can get the result. Value of Pj into Qj dot is nothing but 2T, L is nothing but T minus V, and hence we get H is equals to total energy. Okay. So in the very similar way, now let us start with the new one, that is the second point of the theorem. Okay, given that constraints are economic. In this case, we are again in the case of a conservative system. Okay, what is the question? We are in the case of a conservative system. But in that conservative system, we are in the case of reonomy. Okay. So if system is conservative and constraints are reonomic, in this case, we know that the kinetic energy is a quadratic function of a generalized velocity. Okay. So up to now, you have to put a faith on me that we know that, because I don't know how many of you know this, because already we have done it in the first chapter, that in the first chapter, last theorem, last two to three theorems are there. Kinetic energy is a quadratic function of generalized velocity. After that, we have derived T is equal to T2 plus T1 plus T0. And then we have one, in particular, in case of a reonomic system, we have proved already in the first chapter that summation over J Qj dot dou T by dou Qj dot is 2T2 plus T1. But again, we are in the case of conservative system, hence, potential energy is not a function of generalized velocity. Okay, then Pj is equals to, we get Pj is nothing but dou T by dou Qj dot. So here you have to substitute dou T by dou Qj dot. Instead of having dou T by dou Qj dot, we can substitute Pj. And hence we get the result. And hence you can see that H is not equal to total energy. What do you mean by total energy? H is equals to T plus V, but here it is not T plus V, it is 2T2 plus T1 minus L. So hence we can say H does not represent the total energy, but we can say that H may represent the constant of motion, and for that you can have a proof. H represent the constant of motion. So in that way, in that case, you have to again prove that dH by dt equal to zero. But in this case, it may represent or may not represent. So that's why we are not going to prove. And simply we can say that H may represent the constant of motion, and hence the proof. H does not represent the total energy. However, H may represent the constant of motion. It may represent in some cases, and in some cases it may not represent. And hence we say that H may represent constant of motion, and H does not represent the total energy. Now let us go for the discussion that whatever the cyclic coordinate we have seen. Everyone remembering cyclic coordinate in the first chapter?
Yes, ma'am.
What is cyclic coordinate?
Cyclic coordinates means which is absent in Lagrange's equation.
The coordinate which is absent in L is called a cyclic coordinate. So dou L by dou Qj, if it is equal to zero, then we say that Qj is a cyclic coordinate. Many times while solving the example, I have shown you that whenever you have a L in terms of T minus V, L is equal to T minus V. So at that time, if suppose the equation of L is in terms of X and Y, sometime the value of dou L by dou X was zero. So which means that X is absent in that, and we can say X is a cyclic coordinate. Okay. Now we have to discuss about the cyclic coordinate. What will happen about a cyclic coordinate when it is in Lagrangian, when it is in our Hamiltonian. Okay, because L and H both are different. What is L? L is a function of Qj, Qj dot and T. But what is H? H is a function of Pj, Qj and T. You can see here, L is a function of Qj, Qj dot and T, and H is a function of Pj, Qj and T. Okay. So now we will discuss what will be the effect of a cyclic coordinate. Okay. The use of a cyclic, you can see the statement here, the use of a cyclic coordinate is not so much profitable in the Lagrangian formulation. Why it is not so much profitable? Because you can see here that L is in terms of Qj, Qj dot and T. Okay, just like in the examples we have solved in the first chapter, at that time suppose L is not involving x, but it may involve x dot. होते ना असे एक्झाम्पल सॉल्व केलेत का आपण? In the first chapter, first we have seen the simple pendulum. आठवते का? खूप लांबचा
यस
नाही,
मॅम.
वर्ष अगोदरचा ना. सिंपल पेंड्युलम, देन वी हॅव सीन स्फेरिकल पेंड्युलम, देन वी हॅव सीन अॅटवुड मशीन, देन वी हॅव प्रोजेक्टेड अ पार्टिकल, वी हॅव फाउंड द इक्वेशन फॉर दॅट एल, देन वी हॅव फाउंड द सॉरी लॅग्रेंजिस इक्वेशन ऑफ मोशन विथ एल. So many example we have seen at that time. So if you were studying, you can answer if sometime dou L by dou X was zero. Okay, just like we can say dou L by dou Qj zero, but dou L by dou Qj dot was non-zero. Sometime L involves a variable X, or you can say it may involve Qj, but it may not involve Qj dot, or sometime a vice versa will be there. L may not involve Qj, but it may involve a Qj dot. Okay, so here you can see that if it is involving Qj dot, so again we have to solve that equation. 2-2 equation we have solved now. Sometime it is in terms of r theta. So we have solved these type of a equation in the first chapter, Lagrange's equations of motion. आठवतंय ना सगळ्यांना किती एक्झाम्पल सॉल्व केले होते आपण? Please you can repeat the name. So the use of a cyclic coordinate is not profitable in the Lagrangian formulation, because even if Qj is cyclic in L, but corresponding velocity, that is generalized velocity, was present. Okay, those who are not remembering, if you are blank, go back to your first unit. In that many example we have solved, and observe your equation of L. Okay, in the equation of L we were having some variable. If suppose we are considering x and y, okay, assuming that the Cartesian coordinate itself working as a generalized coordinate. If suppose Cartesian coordinates are itself working as a generalized coordinate, say x, y, sometime the equation L may involve x dot, but it may not involve x. So in the very similar way here you can say it may involve Qj dot, but it does not involve a Qj, but still you have to solve the equation, right? Qj dot asel tar obviously dou L by dou Qj dot we have to find out, and then we have to solve those equation. So we have to deal with still n degrees of freedom, right? So degrees of freedom will not be less, correct? Suppose Qj is there, Qj is cyclic in L, so that means at least one coordinate is cyclic in L. Suppose there are total two coordinate, out of which if x is absent in L, but still you have to deal with x dot, that means still you have to deal with the n degrees of freedom. Okay, so still we have to deal with the n degrees of freedom. However, if Qj is cyclic in Hamiltonian, okay, if Qj is cyclic in Hamiltonian, the corresponding generalized momentum is constant. Why the corresponding generalized momentum is constant? This also we have seen already in the first chapter as well as in the last lecture. I have repeated once again, so that a coordinate which is cyclic in Lagrangian is also cyclic in Hamiltonian. So for that, if suppose qj is cyclic, dou l by dou qj is 0. And now we can use the Lagrange's equation of a motion. So dou l by dou qj, if it is equal to 0, we can have the value of dou l by dou qj dot. What is a dou l by dou qj dot? It is pj. So after integrating, we get the value of a pj is nothing but a constant, and which is nothing but dou l by dou qj dot. And hence we can say that corresponding to cyclic coordinate, pj is a constant. So here also you can say the corresponding to cyclic coordinate, pj is a constant. So here you can say that in the Lagrangian L, if qj is absent, qj dot present, and hence we have to still deal with the n degrees of freedom. And if suppose we were having two equation, we have to solve both the equation. But here in this case of a Hamiltonian, if qj is absent, but corresponding pj will be constant and time t. Now we are having two things. First, L is a function of qj, qj dot and t, and h is a function of pj, qj and t. The degrees of freedom are reduces by 1. Thus the system is left with n minus 1 degrees of freedom. Okay, for that you should know the degrees of freedom. That is nothing but least possible number of linearly independent coordinate. Okay, if you're not having any clear idea about degrees of freedom, go back to YouTube channel, see the lecture where you have introduced the degrees of freedom. Degrees of freedom means what? Least possible number of least possible number of linearly independent coordinate. Okay, it is simply a number. And what is the generalized coordinate? Least possible number of a least possible number of linearly independent coordinate. Just like a very simple example of a simple pendulum, the two coordinate x, y sufficient to describe the position of a particle, but still they are related by equation x square plus y square is equal to l square. So we cannot say that x and y are linearly independent. So that's why we have introduced theta. So theta is a generalized coordinate. Okay, so here also we can say that if qj is cyclic, the corresponding pj is a constant, and no need to deal with the constant. Hence degrees of freedom are reduces by 1. So in that way, if suppose it was done in Lagrangian, the instead of solving two equation, we can solve only one equation. And hence Hamilton procedure is specially adopted in the problem having the cyclic coordinate. The cyclic coordinate asel tar directly upon Hamiltonian procedure adopt karu shakto na, so that we can use Hamilton procedure in case of a cyclic coordinate. But in case of a non-cyclic coordinate, we can use any of the equation, since in case of a cyclic coordinate, for qj is absent, qj dot is present in L. But in case of a cyclic coordinate in Hamiltonian, if qj is absent, the corresponding pj is a constant. So number of degrees of freedom, if it is n, or number of equation you have to solve is 2, then it is reduces by 1. Any doubt up to this?
No, ma'am.
Hence, Hamilton's procedure is specially adopted when we have a cyclic coordinate. Somewhere you can write for H, that means whenever you have the case of a Hamiltonian, or whenever you have the cyclic coordinate, you can directly adopt a Hamilton's procedure. Now these are the example. Find the Lagrangian L from a Hamiltonian H and show that it satisfies Lagrange's equation of a motion. What is H? H is summation over j pj qj dot. So with the help of this only we can find out the value of L. So L is equal to summation over j pj qj dot minus H. Now what is our aim to prove? That L satisfies Lagrange's equation of a motion. Okay. So for that, first you have to find out the value of dou L by dou qj dot, and then which is nothing but pj. Okay, dou L by dou qj dot is pj, dou h by dou qj is, we have to find out from your equation. What is your equation? H, h is in terms of summation over j pj qj dot minus L. So we have to h with respect to qj. After differentiating h with respect to qj, how to differentiate? We have to differentiate h with respect to qj, qj with respect to qj, h with respect to qj dot with respect to qj. While you are differentiating with respect to qj, na, Then h with respect to t, t with respect to qd. Okay. Then in this way we can get the result that here if you want to work for l, what is l with respect to qj, we have to find out first. What is l with respect to qj? Here this equation we have written. L with respect to qj. There is no term of a qj in this case. इथे कुठलीही क्यूजेची टर्म नाही आहे. पी जे इंटू क्यूजे डॉट, सो दिस विल बी झिरो. सो वी हॅव टू सिम्पली फाइंड आउट द डेरिवेटिव्ह ऑफ एच विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू क्यूजे. सो दॅट आफ्टर फाइंडिंग द डेरिवेटिव्ह ऑफ एच विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू क्यूजे, एच इज अ फंक्शन ऑफ पी जे, पी जे विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू क्यू, एच विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू क्यूजे, क्यूजे विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू क्यूजे, एच विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू क्यूजे, क्यूजे विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू टी. ओके, सो हियर दीज टू टर्म्स आर झिरो. वाय दीज आर झिरो? Since we can see here what are the values of h with respect to pj, pj with respect to qj and qj with respect to t. Can anyone give me a reason why dou h by dou qj is zero?